Good morning, everybody. My name is Greg Donoghue. I am a education consultant here in Melbourne, Australia, and I specialise in the teaching of well-being, or the science of well-being, which is a fairly new field. And I intend to produce a few videos for use on YouTube, where we will be demonstrating and teaching some of the techniques that science has shown us will improve people's lives. I would describe the job that I've got now, going around to schools and various community organisations around my state, as probably one of the best jobs I've ever had. I get to see lots of fantastic students and children and to teach them some really good stuff. And I also get to see them improve their happiness levels and their well-being levels and reduce their anxiety and depression almost on a daily basis. And I can think of nothing more rewarding than that. The picture you see there is a picture of me, just to show you that I'm not a random voice at the end of your computer. I'm actually a real person, and I have a real family, and that's one member of my family, my very precocious now 12-year-old daughter Bridie. And I've chosen that photo because down the track in subsequent videos, that the fact that we're doing what we're doing there and having a big smile on our face is actually quite relevant to some of the exercises that that I'll be showing you over the next few videos. So I wanted to introduce this newfangled science of well-being, or this science of happiness, and give you some lessons on what we know improves well-being and people's happiness. And the best way for me to do that would be to describe my history of coming to where I am now in the positive education or in the well-being education area. I started off a very long time ago. I'm a bit embarrassed about how long ago now, but it was certainly several decades ago, studying psychology at university. And we were taught then about how the science of psychology can help people deal with their lives. We learned all about the different things that can go wrong with people's minds, like all the psychological disturbances and psychological conditions. There was a massive book on them, all the things that you can have wrong with your mind, you know, obsessive compulsive disorder and depression and anxiety disorder and all these sorts of things. And as psychology people, we were taught that the science of psychology can help you fix those things in people, as if those people had something wrong with them, just like they were, you know, they had a broken leg or something. The expert doctor, or in this case the expert psychologist, could come along and fix what was wrong with them. And that was okay. That had some limited success, and I'll just draw you, if you stick with these videos, you'll soon know that I'm a bit of a nerd and I like to draw graphs. But if you draw a graph like this and you said, well, along this line here was sort of normal, like, you know, nothing wrong with you, along that line there was normal, and if you had a broken arm, you were down here in the subnormal range, like you were sick, and people would come to the doctor when they were sick, and the doctor would bring them back up to normal. And that was exactly the same as what psychology tried to be. So if you came in to see a psychologist years ago, it was because you might have been depressed, or you might have been anxious, or you might have been lonely, or you've had a trauma. You may have suffered, you know, a major trauma. There was something wrong with you. You probably, not the right word to use, sick, but there was something wrong with you. You had some sort of deficit. And so a psychologist would have expert training into taking you from here and getting you better, so you were back to normal. But then they'd say, well, here's the bill, on your bike, I hope you have a great life. And what positive psychology discovered some years ago, and I'll tell you how and who did that in a moment, was that, gee, what if we said, let's apply our science to go a little bit further. Let's see if we can get people into the positive area. So that's sort of the minus 10 zone. What if we try to get people up into the plus 10 zone? And they just come up with this new phrase or this new word for it, and they sort of call it flourishing. They used to call it just happiness, There's a few other names for it too, which weren't very useful, but now they sort of call it flourishing. How can we get people to flourish in this area? Now, in my work, as I said, I think I've got the best job in the world now, but it wasn't always that way. The job I had before that wasn't quite so exciting. Well, that's not true. It was pretty exciting. It wasn't quite so positive. I used to be a detective in the local police force here in Melbourne, Australia, Victoria Police, and I spent well over a decade in that job. But I spent probably about half of that time specialising in an area called, specialising in an area investigating serious crimes against children. Now, I've got a little bit of a graphic here which I've just taken off the net. It's not somebody personal, but it's just a graphic off the net, sort of demonstrating the sorts of things that we were investigating, you know, where an adult would break the law and commit crimes against children in various ways. And in that picture, it's a pretty nasty one where the child's being abused and is obviously very distressed. We would come in a little bit like the traditional psychologist. We'd come into that situation where it wasn't very, very good. Obviously, in that photograph, the man's very, very angry and abusive. He's got problems. The girl's obviously very distressed and anxious and possibly traumatized by what's happening. She's not very happy. We as coppers would come into that situation. We'd lock up the offender, put him in jail. We'd take the child out and help them deal with what's happened and put them in connection to psychologists and to social workers and that sort of thing to hope that she would get better. And generally they did. It was a pretty good result. I couldn't stop thinking, though, that in all the time I was doing that, we were really operating not so much as we weren't helping as best we could. And I first described it by saying that we were a little bit like this. We were a little bit like the ambulance at the bottom of the mountain. As police, we had to wait until something had happened to the child before we could intervene. We couldn't intervene until a crime had been committed. And by that stage, sadly, in many cases, it was too late. You could do something to help improve it, but it wasn't great. So I started to think, instead of applying our scientific knowledge, which we've got plenty of, instead of applying that to fixing things that had already gone wrong, why don't we focus on up here? Why don't we focus on putting a safety barrier at the top of the mountain, at the top of the cliff, so that people don't fall down in the first place? And that's when I started to think about using psychology as a preventative measure. So, you know, psychology as prevention, which wasn't really very well discussed in the science, because we were operating from that medical model where we knew we think we could fix things. Now, in the mid-90s, that all changed by a bloke who used to be a traditional psychologist, and he used to write books on abnormal psychology. He used to write books and do investigations on traditional psychology stuff. But then it's like he almost sort of saw the light eventually, and he wrote a series of books which have now become known as positive psychology. Instead of trying to fix people and getting them back to normal, he started to ask the question, well, regardless of what's happened to you in the past, regardless of what trauma you may have suffered, are there things that we can do? Are there things that we can learn to help us become happier, more resilient, have higher levels of well-being, regardless of what's happened to us? And the answer was overwhelmingly yes, there are. And the answer was overwhelmingly yes, because this new science of psychology started to measure things scientifically. And they discovered very, very quickly that there are some things that you can do, there are some habits you can form, there are some techniques that you can follow, there are some thinking practices that you can do, which are scientifically proven to make you happier and more resilient and have higher levels of well-being throughout your life. So in the next few videos, who knows how many there are going to be, I'll do as many as we can, as many as need be, all for free, all available all around the world. we're going to study some of those techniques. So regardless of what's happened to you in your past, regardless of how happy you are naturally born or how unhappy you are naturally born, regardless of all those things, I will teach you some techniques to use on a daily basis or a regular basis that we know for a fact, as confidently as we know about gravity, we know for a fact that these things will improve your levels of happiness and your levels of well-being. And we will start those in the next video.